Hello, everyone. I'm going to answer the questions that Mr. Drescher has sent me, and I'm going to read out the questions out loud before I answer them. So here goes. Number one, you first met Louis Zamperini in the summer of 1996 when you were working on his story in preparation for the 1998 Olympics in Japan. What was your first meeting with Louis like? Well, I had reached him on the telephone in early August of 96. I thought he was dead. I didn't realize that he was still with us, and I fully expected to get that news on the phone, and I was quite surprised that he was still alive. And we set up a meeting at his home in Hollywood, of all places, in September of 96. So the first day I went there and I had my notepad, and after about 3.5 hours of sitting there writing furiously in my notepad as he talked and talked and talked, I finally realized that I was sitting across a 79-year-old man, and I thought, wow, I've been really rude. I haven't asked if he needs to take a break. You know, heck, I needed to take a break. So I finally said, Louis, do you want to stop? You know, get something to eat, have a drink, use the facilities? And he said, what? No, let's keep on going. So we went another 3.5 hours, so 7 hours on that first day. My hand cramped, but I had some great notes. And then it spilled over into the next day. We went over to the church, his office at the church, and he showed me all the artifacts that he had collected and souvenirs over the years. The guy was like a squirrel, fortunately, and he collected everything. So he had the radio broadcast from Japan. He had some film of his return to Japan. So it was we got off to a great start that first day. Question number two. During World War II, Louis survived 47 days in an with almost no food or supplies. What prior experiences do you think helped Louis survive? Well, certainly the fact that he was a long-distance runner and he was used to pain, you know, contributed to that. But you're talking about a 5,000-meter race, which pales in comparison to being on a raft with practically no food for 47 days. The only other experience that I think that could help prepare him for that was, you know, he was a bit of a rascal when he was a kid. So early on, he would go train hopping with his friend, and, you know, he basically ran away from home. And off he went with, you know, a few supplies and didn't have anything to eat. So he would have to sort of forage for any kind of food that he had. But I don't really think that anything could have prepared him for the 47 days on a raft. Question number three. In working on Louis' story, you discovered that the bird, the guard who had tortured Louis, was alive. What was your reaction when you learned that Mutsuhiro Watanabe was alive? Complete shock. I was in Japan. I went to the last prisoner of war camp or the site of the last prisoner of war camp where Louis was held. And while I was there, I got a message that the head of the Japanese Australian Friendship Society wanted to meet with me. And I thought, oh my God, I'm sure I rolled my eyes. You know, I don't really have time for this, but we're in Japan, and, you know, this is one of the courtesies that you have to sort of extend to be nice to people who want to be nice to you. So this gentleman had invited myself and my interpreter to lunch. So over the course of noodles, we started talking about this memorial that they had built, the Japanese Australian Friendship Society, at the site of the former POW camp in Naoetsu. In fact, 62 Australian prisoners had died there during the course of the war, so it meant a lot, particularly to the families of the former POWs in Australia. But this gentleman was telling me that the memorial was erected to great opposition in Japan. And in fact, out of about 70 former POW sites in Japan, this was the only one that had any sort of, you know, statue or any sort of memorial that even indicated that there was a prisoner of war camp that was there. It's a very sensitive subject in Japan. And he said that a lot of the families of the former prison guards, Japanese prison guards, were vociferously against the building of this little statue. And they demanded that there be a parallel statue to the memory of the prison guards. So he said, you know, at the end, they finally got it through. They didn't have to put together a statue for the prison guards, but it was not easy. There was very intense opposition. So as he was saying this, and we were slurping our noodles at his house, he said, I asked him, I said, did you ever hear about this one prison guard named Watanabe? Because, you know, I had heard this from the American prisoners who were at Naoetsu, but I didn't know what the Japanese reaction was. And this guy said, oh, yeah, I mean, this guy was really terrible news. He was awful. And I was heartened that he, you know, had the same reaction that the Americans did. It was just confirmation for me. But also, you know, a little bit surprised. And I said, you know, whatever happened to that guy? Did they ever find his body? And he was slurping his noodle. He says, oh, he's not dead. And then, you know, at first I kind of scoffed. And I said, what do you mean he's not dead? He says, no, he's still alive, and I have his phone number. I literally dropped my spoon in my soup. And then I thought for a second, well, hang on. You're the head of the Japanese-Australian Friendship Society in Nauwetsu. How do you know, and how do you have his phone number? And so he said, no, it was given to me by somebody who knew him and had worked with him in a prison camp, and I was sworn to secrecy never to give it away. So I bluffed, and I said, listen, I'm going to get that phone number eventually, but you can save me 6 months of work if you hand me over that phone number, and I will never divulge who gave it to me. He thought for a second. He said, well, let me think about that. So we continued our meals, slurped our noodles, finished, said our goodbyes. I was on his porch, and he said, hang on a second, as if he wanted to go get his jacket or something. And he came back, and he shook my hand, and I could feel that in the handshake there was a piece of paper. I knew what was happening. I put it in my pocket. We got into the car. We said our goodbyes. And then I unfurled it. And in fact, it was the phone number for Matsuhiro Watanabe. And that's how the whole process started as to how we found him. Question number four. You became friends with Louis and spoke this summer at his memorial service. You said, to be with a man who personified the triumph of good over evil was invigorating. How was it possible for Louis to forgive the bird? That's one of the enduring questions. And one of the sort of things that stood out about his story. I don't think that there's any way that he would have forgiven the bird had he not met Reverend Billy Graham back in the early 1950s. So if he had actually been forced to go there then by his wife, because Louis was a mess at the time. Louis was an alcoholic. He was having tremendous nightmares about his POW experience, particularly at the hands of the bird. And he very reluctantly went to the sermon that the Reverend Billy Graham was giving in Los Angeles. And then after that, to serve the Lord, he was asked to go to Japan on a mission where he would face his former POWs, or former prison guards. And Louis was not terribly happy about doing that. He was very ambivalent about it, to say the least. But I think once he had that experience, and there's, wonderful film of Louis going there and, astonishing his guards by, offering a hand and talking to them and forgiving them, I think that sort of built the scenario where he decided that, he wanted to forgive the bird. Now, he was fully expecting on that trip to see the bird and to forgive him in person. And the bird wasn't there. And what Louis had heard was that the bird had gone missing and then had committed suicide. So Louis, up until 1996, from that moment on, in the early 50s to 1996, just assumed that the bird was dead. Number five, how did Louis' faith influence the way he lived? Well, for starters, he was very much a religious man. After that, he was a lay minister. He worked out of the Presbyterian Church in Hollywood. And I'll give you a little story, and I found this out at the memorial service, and I think this says everything about the way Louis, how he became a bigger man. There was a young man at the memorial service who spoke. I'd never seen him, never heard of him. He was quite compelling. He got up there. He was in sort of, shirt sleeves and blue jeans. And he told the story about how he came across Louis. He had been kicked out of school, was on drugs, tried to get himself through rehab, and met Louis, at a rehab session or something like that. And Louis took a liking to him and really wanted him to get straightened out. And this kid had a chance to go to a college in Australia, but he didn't have the money. And Louis said, don't worry about that. He said, well, what do you mean? He said, just get in. And he did. And Louis took care of his entire tuition. The kid went to Australia, went to school for 4 years, and came back and completely turned his life around. And he credits it completely to Louis. So Louis had a huge heart. And I think that his faith played a large, large role in that. Last question, number six. Please tell us your favorite Louis story. Well, there are many, but I want to focus on two, actually, which happened in the same day. So for this story, I wanted to have the best cameraman that I could possibly have, and that was Chris Everson, who was based out of Cape Town, South Africa. So I flew him all the way from South Africa to Los Angeles, where we were going to sit down with Louis for what I knew was going to be a really long interview. Remember, that first session that I had with him lasted 7 hours. So Chris was setting up the camera, and as he was starting to set up, Louis asked him, he said, you know, I detect the accent, where are you from? He says, oh, I'm from Cape Town, South Africa. I said, oh yeah, that's great. It's actually a little town called Paarl, South Africa. And Louis said, oh yeah, Paarl, I know Paarl. And Chris said, really? You know Paarl? And Louis said, oh yeah. And so Chris kind of looked at me, flashed me a look like, yeah, right, buddy. And so we started to continue to set up the cameras, and Louis got a little bit quiet, and then he came back and he started recounting a story. He said, you know, when I was in the POW camp, the Cape of Good Wine, and it was about a family that lived on this farm called Languedoc. And Chris kind of looked at me and he said, you're winding me up, right? I said, no, what are you talking about? He turned to Louis and said, Louis, I live on a farm called Languedoc, and that's my farm. And Louis said, you know, this is, I thought, like, this can't possibly be true. And neither, Chris didn't really believe it, but it was just too much of a coincidence. Anyway, we started to set up for the interview, and Chris asked me to take a look at the background, and he set up a really nice background, and in the behind Louis, there was going to be some shades there. I mean, some Venetian blinds almost. And the sun was poking through. It was a really nice shot. And I said, Chris, I looked at the monitor. I said, Chris, this looks great, but what are you going to do when the sun goes down? Now, the interview was set to start at 1 p.m. Chris looked at me. He said, well, surely we'll be done by, what time does the sun go down? 6? Surely we'll be done by then. I said, Chris, believe me, I've got a lot of questions, and this guy's got a lot of answers. And he said, okay, well, we'll deal with it when the time comes. So I asked the first question, sat Louis down, asked the first question. I said, Louis, what were you like as a kid? 11 minutes later, Louis finished his answer. I turned around, I looked at my cameraman, Chris, and Chris had both hands on his head and said, oh my God. And so the interview, believe me, the sun went down, we had to change the shot, we had to put a light outside, and the interview lasted until 8 p.m. And when we were breaking down, Louis sort of had this look on his face like, where are you guys going? Anyway, 6 weeks later, Louis gets a package in the mail. It's from South Africa, and it's the book, Cape of Good Wine. Chris had found it in a township in a library, and he asked the librarian, said, well, what would happen if I check this book out and don't return it? Librarian said, oh, that would be, oof, you'd pay a fine. He said, well, how much would I have to pay? He said, well, that'd be about 5 rand, which was about the equivalent of like 35 cents at the time. Chris said, I tell you what, how about I give you 100 rand and we call it a day? And that's how he got the book to Louis. Anyway, thank you for listening.